Good morning. On behalf of the Executive Secretary of the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, Mr. Emilio Álvarez y Casa, it's an honor to welcome you to the roundtable on Guantanamo. This morning we are going to have a very simple format. We have four speakers. Everyone is going to have 15 minutes for a presentation, and then we are going to have 30 minutes for an interchange of questions and answers. We start the morning with our Assistant Executive Secretary, Mrs. Elizabeth Abimerchet. She is our legal director since 2007. She's in charge of coordinating and supervising the preparation of all reports on cases and reports on thematic and country situation. She has worked at the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights since 1992. Elizabeth Abimerchet studied law at American University Washington College of Law and did her master studies in international and comparative law at George Washington University. Elizabeth, you have the floor.
Thank you. Good morning. So today is an auspicious day for the presentation of this report and for this panel because it is Human Rights Day. So I greet you all in that spirit. I thank you all for being with us and sharing this time. My role in the panel is to give a brief presentation of the Commission's report on the situation at Guantanamo Bay for the detainees towards the closure of the facility. And I want to start by saying that this is not a new issue for the Commission. The Commission has been working on the situation at Guantanamo for the detainees since the very beginning. And before I go into the report, I just want to mention that the Commission has used all of its mechanisms to deal with the situation. Precautionary measures, resolutions, the individual case system, hearings before the Commission, expert meetings, requests to visit the Guantanamo facility, and this report represents the latest step in that process. If we think about the precautionary measures, they give us a kind of picture of what the Commission has been looking at over the years. After the detainees were first placed in the Guantanamo facility in 2002, 2 months after the first detainees were taken there, the Commission first issued precautionary measures requiring the government to determine their legal status. At that point, the government was saying that the federal courts in the U.S. didn't have jurisdiction over the detainees, and they didn't fit the paradigm for prisoners of war either. So the U.S. was effectively saying there was no applicable legal regime. They didn't have recognized rights as detainees. So the Commission's first step was to require the government to make a determination of what their legal status was so that it could be understood what rights would attach to that legal status. In 2005, following consistent, widespread allegations of torture and inhuman treatment in Guantanamo, the Commission amplified the precautionary measures to respond to those allegations and to require the government to investigate and take measures to ensure that torture would not be practiced in the facility. And then again in 2013, the Commission amplified the precautionary measures, in this case, taking into account the persistence of the indefinite detention, the difficult practices there, including forced feeding of hunger strikers, and requiring the government to close the facility as part of the precautionary measures. What the report reflects is the evolution of the situation up to now to focus on current challenges, the ongoing violation of the rights of the detainees, and what the Commission has called for over the years, which is the closing of the facility. The report is on the Commission's webpage in English and Spanish. The press office of the Commission has prepared a multimedia presentation that is available through our webpage. It talks about the relationship between the reports and the other mechanisms of the Commission, and there are links so that one can see all of the other work that's been done on the issue. And I also want to recognize the commitment of the commission over the years since the very beginning to this issue and of the legal team, and mention the work of one of our lawyers, Analia Banfi, in helping to prepare this report. And since I don't have a watch, you're going to help me.
Yes, that's my work.
You're going to tell me. Yeah. I also want to mention that the commission's work on these issues tracks very closely the process of government-issued memos and policies and practices that sought to undermine some of the most basic non-derogable human rights for these detainees. From the start, the idea of holding these detainees in Guantanamo Bay was intended to keep them, to maintain them outside of federal court jurisdiction. The memos that were later published in the press, known as the torture memos, suggested that the detainees had no recognizable legal status and thus no protected rights, that torture was not prohibited in the scenario of the Guantanamo Bay detainees, or that short of provoking permanent disability or death, the enhanced, quote unquote, enhanced interrogation practices provoking extreme suffering were not torture. These memos are part of what the commission was reacting to over time. And the report, in this sense, reminds us that in times of extreme challenge, of extreme pressure against basic rights, the international law commitments that states freely undertake provide a fundamental protection against attempts to undermine basic rights. And in that sense, the U.S. is a member state of the OAS. The U.S., as a signatory and ratifying party to the OAS Charter, has undertaken to uphold basic human rights. The commission has competence to work with those rights through the American Declaration and the commission statute. We sometimes hear in the commission that the U.S. is outside the system. The U.S. is not outside the system. The U.S. is part of the system. It hasn't ratified the American Convention, but the commission has full competence to monitor the human rights situation with respect to the United States. Furthermore, the fundamental rights and obligations that the commission is looking at in this report are, by and large, norms of customary international law. So the source of competence for the commission is very clear, I think. When we look at this report, what it's focusing on is the main human rights violations that the commission has identified for the detainees at Guantanamo Bay. Indefinite detention, detention without charge or trial, the commission emphasizes, reiterates, that this cannot be made legitimate by invoking a public security justification. After a reasonable time has lapsed, detention becomes a serious violation of the right to liberty in any scenario. The commission recognizes that the right to liberty may be subject to certain limitations, and in emergency circumstances, those restrictions may be extended. But in all cases, such detention must be subject to certain controls. It cannot be indefinite, and it must be subject to judicial supervision. UN mandate holders have reached similar conclusions. The CAT, the Committee Against Torture, has established that indefinite detention is in and of itself a violation of the Convention Against Torture. The Commission, for its part, concludes that under both international humanitarian law and international human rights law, indefinite detention in Guantanamo for more than a decade is a violation of the right to liberty. The next issue that the Commission focuses on is the use of torture and cruel, inhuman, and degrading punishment. The Commission looks at this situation in different parts. During the early years, the so-called enhanced interrogation techniques included waterboarding, beating, and electric shocks. The contention at the time is that that wasn't torture, but enhanced techniques. The commission looks at those techniques. The commission looks also at the role and responsibility of health professionals who participated in planning or responding to those practices, some of whom were actually present during those practices. The commission also looks at the way in which the U.S. Senate Select Committee on Intelligence, its report, concluded that detainees were tortured during these years at Guantanamo. And the commission recognizes that it's not just the commission, but the Committee Against Torture, the UN Rapporteur on Torture, and other UN mandate holders have issued similar conclusions and calls for these practices to cease, and of course for the allegations of torture and inhuman treatment to be investigated, prosecuted, and punished. The Commission recognizes certain improvements in conditions as from 2009 with the arrival of the Obama administration. The Commission recognizes in this report that there has been an evolution in the situation. The Commission recognizes President Obama's commitment to close the detention center, and in fact, this is a fundamental condition for work on this issue to advance. The Commission recognizes that the second day of President Obama's administration, he issued an executive order concerning lawful interrogation. In 2009, there were finally individualized reviews of the legal status of the remaining detainees in Guantanamo. And there was a decision to investigate the terror memos that had been written to try to authorize these enhanced techniques that amounted to torture. And this investigation established that those memos, the preparation and issuance of the memos, was a form of professional misconduct. These are important steps in a process, but at the same time, no criminal actions have been taken against those responsible for the torture. The detention persists for 107 detainees, and the report looks at ongoing challenges. The report looks at the continuing indefinite detention as itself cruel, inhuman, and degrading. The Commission looks in the report at the conditions at Camp 7, where the so-called high-value detainees are held, isolated from other detainees, isolated from contact with their families, even by phone. And the Commission looks at aggressive and unnecessary searches held on a daily basis. The Commission also looks at the question of force-feeding detainees on hunger strikes, which has happened periodically over these years. And in 2013, when the Commission was looking again at the precautionary measures and working on preparing this report, the majority of the detainees were on a hunger strike, and a significant number of them were being force-fed. If any of us in this room decided to go on a hunger strike as a measure of protest, it would not be constitutionally permissible for us to be force-fed against our will. And yet this is what happens and has been happening at Guantanamo. The detainees are force-fed against their will. The Commission, other UN bodies have looked at this as a conflict with the right to freedom of expression, have looked at this as a form of painful and degrading treatment. And this report is one of the first times that the Commission has had the opportunity to look at force feeding and hunger strike as a very specific issue. There are three other issues I want to touch on. The first is denial of or limited access to justice. The second is denial of due process, including denial of the right to an adequate defense. And the third is the question of the discriminatory detention regime designed to hold and try foreign Muslim men. Before I wrap up, I want to make sure I mention those three things. Mm-hmm. With respect to denial of or limited access to justice, the report indicates that clearly detainees, as with anybody under the effective control of any member state of the OAS, they must have access to justice to be able to question the legality of their detention. This is an absolutely basic fundamental right. Across countries and contexts throughout the region, the Commission has emphasized this point, and that judicial protection and supervision is the safeguard, the primary safeguard against the arbitrary use and abuse of state power, and an essential component in a democratic system. The Commission looks at how, over the years, the detainees have been either unable to access justice or been able to access justice, but in very restricted conditions. So when we look at the question of denial of due process, including denial of the right to an adequate defense, what are we looking at? We're looking at the fact that during the initial years, the government was saying that the detainees had no, that the federal courts had no competence to exercise jurisdiction over them. It took 8 years before the federal courts confirmed that, yes, in fact, they did have jurisdiction to receive habeas corpus writs from the detainees, 8 years. Once that competence was confirmed, What the commission looks at in this report is that the burden for the government to justify detention is lower in these cases than it would be for other cases. There are certain presumptions applied in favor of government evidence, in favor of government documentation, information. Hearsay evidence can be admitted against Guantanamo detainees, whereas it would not be admissible in any other court scenario. Detainees very often don't have access to all of the information that is brought against them because it's classified, because it's protected. In the inter-American system, the right to habeas corpus is a fundamental, non-derogable protection. The report looks at the negative impact of these practices in particular cases over time as a violation of the right to fair trial and judicial protection. The commission also looks at the way in which Guantanamo detainees have significant barriers to having contact with their lawyers. Certain issues are off limits. They cannot be discussed between detainees and their lawyers. There are practical difficulties for lawyers to go to Guantanamo to consult with their clients. There are difficulties with having other forms of contact between detainees and their lawyers. Along these same lines, it is one of the points that the report looks at, one of the really unusual characteristics of this problematic is that U.S. prosecutors take the position that the memories and experiences of Guantanamo detainees in terms of the treatment that they experienced are classified. So that for detainees who experienced torture, U.S. prosecutors take the position that that information is classified. Accordingly, how can they denounce and seek judicial remedies for torture if they're not able to reveal the treatment that they experienced, except before military commissions of the Defense Department, not before courts? This is a highly problematic situation with respect to the right to seek redress and accountability. And here we are on Human Rights Day. We're looking at questions of truth, justice, and accountability on Human Rights Day. And this is precisely the kind of practice that prohibits that possibility. It excludes that possibility. So the commission concludes that while there have been improvements in the military commission system, that system does not comply with the right to due process and to be tried by a competent, independent, impartial court previously established by law. And then another point that the commission looks at that's a very delicate point in this problematic, and it's a point that's come up in the last couple of days with the remarks of some candidates in our presidential election process. The policies that have been applied to Guantanamo Bay detainees don't expressly target foreign Muslim men, but if we look at the facts, if we look at who's been detained at Guantanamo, every detainee is a foreign Muslim man. It is a detention regime that has been designed and applied only to a group that is characterized by a particular ethnicity, nationality, set of nationalities, and religion. And that is simply a fact on the ground. The effect of the policies reaches one set of people. Recommendations that the commission makes in this report. The analysis is the base for recommendations, and I'll just conclude very briefly with this. The commission is indicating in this report, emphasizing in this report, that detainees who are going to be charged and tried should be brought and held in the United States and subjected to the jurisdiction of U.S. federal courts. If they are going to be tried, that is how they should be tried, according to the commission's report. Any transfers of detainees who have been cleared for transfer, and many have to be carried out in accordance with the principle of non-refoulement. If they would be subject to risk in a country where they would be removed to, the principle of non-refoulement has to be applied to seek a different alternative. For those who are not going to be charged, not going to be tried, they need to be released immediately. That is the principal conclusion that the commission emphasizes over and over again in the report. All allegations of torture and abuse must be fully investigated, prosecuted, and punished. Information related to torture, related to these practices, should be declassified and available for investigation. The commission welcomes the efforts that have been made by the Obama administration in this direction toward closing the facility and calls for the administration to redouble its efforts. The commission also calls on OAS member states to consider receiving detainee transfers as a way of assisting in resolving this problematic. Thank you.
Thank you, Elizabeth, for your presentation of the report of the Inter-American Commission on towards the closure of Guantanamo in this special day, the International Human Rights Day, and to remember us the recommendations of the commissions. But our second guest is Mr. Charles Trumbull. Mr. Trumbull has served as Deputy Special Envoy for Guantanamo Closure at the Department of State since 2013 and was the Acting Special Envoy from January to July of this year. Prior to this assignment, he worked in the Office of the Legal Advisor, focusing on both international humanitarian law and international human rights law. Mr. Trumbull also served as legal advisor of the U.S. Embassy in Baghdad in 2010. And before joining the Department of State, Mr. Trumbull clerked on the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals and at the International Criminal Court of in The Hague. Mr. Trumbull received an B.A. from Dartmouth College and a J.D. from Vanderbilt Law School. Thank you, Mr. Trumbull, for accepting our invitation, and you have the floor.
Well, good morning and buenos dias. Thank you very much for this opportunity to speak on this roundtable on Guantanamo Bay Detention Facility. It is a pleasure to appear again before this commission. The United States appreciates the commission's extensive efforts in preparing this report towards the closure of Guantanamo and supports the Commission in the strong sense of integrity and independence that has historically characterized its work. Now, I cannot speak to all of the recommendations contained in this report, but I would refer you to the United States March 30th response for greater details on our position. Now, I would like, however, to address a few of the recommendations in the report, including the recommendation to close the detention center at Guantanamo Bay, which is the primary focus of my job. The United States remains fully committed to this goal. President Obama has repeatedly stated and reaffirmed this commitment, including in his State of the Union address earlier this year. The President has stated that closing the detention facility at Guantanamo is a national security imperative and that its continued operation weakens our national security by draining resources, damaging our relationships with key allies and partners, and emboldening violent extremists. This is not just President Obama's view. Senior government officials in national security, military, intelligence, and foreign affairs from both the Obama and Bush administrations have also expressed the same opinion, and dozens of retired military generals and admirals have also stressed the imperative of closing Guantanamo detention facility. The United States has undertaken significant efforts to reduce the detainee population at Guantanamo in a responsible manner, and ultimately to close the facility. Currently, there are 107 detainees remaining at Guantanamo. 48 of these detainees have been approved for transfer by the unanimous consensus of 6 departments and agencies in the United States government. 49 are in the process of being reviewed by the Periodic Review Board, or PRB, which I'll also speak to in a moment. And 10 are in the military commission's process. Importantly, more than 85% of the detainees once held at Guantanamo have now been transferred. The Obama administration, for its part, has transferred 131 detainees, which is well over half of the 242 detainees that were at Guantanamo when the president came into office. In the last 2 years alone, despite the onerous and unwarranted restrictions in the National Defense Authorization Act, we have transferred 57 detainees. We expect to transfer a significant number of detainees in the next couple of months, bringing the number below 100, which I think will be a very significant milestone in the history of Guantanamo. And I guarantee that we will continue to accelerate the pace of transfers in 2016. We have also made significant progress on another recommendation in this commission's report, which is transferring the Yemeni nationals. Unfortunately, as many of you know, given the security situation in Yemen, repatriation to Yemen is not a viable option at this time. Nevertheless, we have transferred or resettled 23 Yemenis over the past year, including 10 to Oman, 3 to Georgia, 3 to Kazakhstan, 1 to Slovakia, and 1 to Estonia. And most recently, 5 to the United Arab Emirates. Detainees who are approved for transfer should not remain in detention solely because of their nationality, and we are fully committed to transferring all the Yemeni nationals who are approved for transfer. Finally, we intend to expedite the periodic review board process, consistent with this commission's recommendation. As many of you know, the periodic review board is the interagency body that determines whether the continued detention of a Gitmo detainee is necessary to protect against a significant threat to the security of the United States. The PRB comprises a senior representative from 6 departments and agencies: the Department of Defense, the Joint Chiefs of Staff, the Director of National Intelligence, the Department of Justice, the Department of Homeland Security, and the Department of State. Detainees appearing before the PRB have at least one personal representative to advocate on his behalf, and they can also elect to have private counsel. If they elect, detainees can submit evidence to the board, call witnesses, and answer questions posed by board members. Thus far, 21 detainees have been reviewed by the Periodic Review Board. Of those, the PRB has approved 15 for transfer and recommended a continued detention for only 3. 3 cases remain pending. Any detainee not approved for transfer during his initial PRB hearing will receive, at a minimum, a file review within 6 months or every 6 months thereafter, and another full hearing in 3 years. They might also receive a full hearing earlier if warranted based on new information. We are working to significantly increase the pace of the PRB hearings so that all detainees eligible will receive a hearing in 2016. Looking forward in 2016, we will continue our efforts to close Guantanamo along 4 tracks. Number 1, transfer all the detainees who are currently approved for transfer. Number 2, review in the PRB those detainees not approved for transfer, and then transfer any of those that are subsequently approved. Number 3, prosecute all those detainees who can and should be prosecuted. And number 4, work with Congress to lift the unnecessary and unwarranted restrictions on bringing detainees to the United States. In order to finally close Guantanamo, we need the help of our friends and allies around the world. Significantly, since 2009, 23 countries have accepted detainees, many of those Yemenis, who cannot return to their home country because of treatment or security concerns. In particular, I want to thank the governments of Uruguay and El Salvador for their very important humanitarian decision to accept such detainees. And in closing, I would like to echo another recommendation from this commission, that all OAS states seriously consider taking Guantanamo detainees for resettlement so we can finally close this chapter on Guantanamo. Thank you, and I look forward to the discussion after this panel.
Thank you, Mr. Trumbull. You left us 7 minutes. We appreciate your generosity. Okay, perfect. And thank you also for your remarks on the measures adopted by the United States government towards the closure of Guantanamo and to the fulfillment of the Inter-American Commission recommendations. Our third panelist is Mr. Will Dixon. Mr. Will Dixon is a senior staff attorney at the Center for Constitutional Rights, where he specializes in challenging unlawful detentions in the Guantanamo prison. Mr. Will represents clients in federal court, before the military commissions at Guantanamo, and in various international proceedings. Mr. Walls is a graduate of the University of Colorado School of Law and a former clerk to federal Judge Christopher Dronit in Connecticut. Mr. Walls is frequently cited as Guantanamo expertise in major outlets, including news as the New York Times, the Washington Post, the Miami Herald, among others. Thank you, Mr. Dixon. You have the floor.
Great. Well, thank you, and thank you again for inviting me to participate in today's panel. I will say, as I was preparing my remarks for today and rereading the report, it was like a trip down memory lane. You know, it made me think about how long we've been working on these cases. It made me think that it was 10 years ago this month that I made my first trip to Guantanamo to meet with a detainee. It was the first time that I met Rick, who was also there. We met in Camp Echo, which is one of the camps. 7.5 years ago that we filed our merits case before the commission on behalf of Algerian Jamel Mezian. It's been 2 years since he was forcibly returned to Algeria in violation of the precautionary measures. And you know, after that, after such a long period of time, it seems in many ways a cliche to say it, but I'll say it again. You know, we're really at a crisis point now in the history of Guantanamo. As Charlie mentioned, there are 107 men remaining. Half of them are approved for transfer. But President Obama has only 1 year left to close the prison down. So that's to deal not only with the cleared men, but to deal with the other men as well. And we at the Center for Constitutional Rights and the men who are detained are increasingly concerned that that's not going to happen. We're increasingly worried that the prison is not going to close before the end of the Obama administration. You can imagine the effect that has had on the men who are detained there. I think it's fair to say that most of the men who are still in Guantanamo fully expect to die there. They don't ever expect to be released. And back in 2005 and 2006, when Rick and I were going down and meeting with these men, you know, at that time they were talking about their families and they were telling their families to forget about them, to pretend that they were gone, that they were dead, because they didn't expect to get out. And so you can imagine now, 10 years later, sort of where they are in terms of their thinking, you know, and a lot of the children that were babies or were born after they were detained have grown up. They don't know their family members who were detained. Even the older children who did know them have grown up and they have their own families now. And life goes on for everyone except for the men who are detained in Guantanamo. And so a lot of them, unfortunately, have very little hope that they're ever going to get out of Guantanamo. And even if they do get out, they face a number of challenges after their release, which we try to work with them on. But, you know, at this point, I mean, we're about to enter the 15th year of Guantanamo. And, you know, think about it. Most of these men, almost all of them, have been detained without charge or without trial, right? You can, I think it's fair to say, in the United States, kill somebody or commit another violent act and spend a significantly less time in a U.S. prison than these men have, most of whom have never committed any sort of violent or hostile act against anybody. So, you know, the reasons why these men were brought to Guantanamo are in many ways long forgotten, right? This is history at this point. The many, many errors and mistakes and violations of law that have occurred at Guantanamo are in many ways now, they're too numerous to count or to mention, right? I think one of the things that the report, the commission's report, does very effectively is documents all of this, right? I mean, I don't think after 14 years there's really any question, any serious question, that that the continued detention of men in Guantanamo without charge or trial violates international law. I mean, it's clearly classic arbitrary detention. It violates every human rights instrument that I'm aware of, not to mention U.S. domestic law and international humanitarian law. I think there's also little question, little serious question at this point, that the men in Guantanamo were subjected to torture and other cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment. I think there's no question at this point that Guantanamo, in practice, if not by design, was a prison created, intended to be entirely outside the law, and designed and intended to be a prison exclusively for men who are Muslim. And at this point, men who are Muslim and from the country of Yemen, right? Because that's really who we're talking about. It's the overwhelming majority of the detainee population. And again, the report does a very good job of documenting this, of creating a historical record about this. But it, you know, for purposes of the men who are detained, right? The critical question at this point is, how is the report going to translate into effective progress for these men, right? What is it going to take for the administration to increase the rate of transfers, to reduce the number of men held in indefinite detention, to abandon the military commissions and bring detainees to federal court for prosecution, right? There's really, I think, only one answer at this point, and that is that the President of the United States, Barack Obama, has to take bold action. He's got to do what he's not been willing to do in the last several years of his administration. He's got 1 year left, you know, and Charlie and the State Department have been doing absolutely everything that they can to reduce the detainee population. And in fact, you know, as the time pressure increases in a countdown to the end of the administration, it sort of crystallizes everybody's efforts, including ours, to try to reduce the population and get the place closed. I mean, it's a very effective in focusing everyone on that goal. But, you know, there are still agencies within the U.S. government that continue to obstruct and to delay the progress toward closure. Specifically, in our view, at the center of the Defense Department is standing in the way, in many respects, of Guantanamo closure. And so it's going to take the President of the United States to rectify that situation, right? The President says, as Charlie mentioned, that he's committed to closing Guantanamo. He said that for many, many years, and we take him at his word. We believe him when he says that, but we don't think that he is using his current existing legal authority to make that happen, certainly not to make it happen fast enough to ensure closure before he leaves office. You know, the president thus far, you know, occasionally will make, and somewhat more frequently in the last several months, will make statements about the need to close Guantanamo as a national security priority, as a moral imperative, and then really sort of defers to the agencies in his administration to make that happen, and it's just not effective, right? It's not effective. The president has to be personally engaged. And we, you know, it's not working, really, to close the prison. We see this. I'll give you one example. I believe is talked about in the report is a client of ours named Tariq Bauda. This is a 35-year-old man from who's a Yemeni citizen, grew up in Saudi Arabia, who has been on a hunger strike for 8 years. He hasn't had food in 8 years. He weighs 74 pounds, which is about the average weight of a healthy 10-year-old boy in the United States. And he's been cleared for release for years. He's been cleared to leave Guantanamo for years, but hasn't been transferred, and largely, in our view, because he's a Yemeni citizen. So we brought a legal challenge to his continuing detention earlier this year, and the government, the Justice Department, the Defense Department, are fighting this case as if it were 2003, right? So they are fighting to keep an individual detained in Guantanamo, despite the fact that that he's been cleared for release for years. They want to release him, and he may die in Guantanamo at any time, really, because he's so gravely ill. It doesn't make sense. There's a gap between what the administration says it's going to do, says it wants to do, which is to close the prison, and what's actually happening in practice, right? There's a disconnect here. And so we have a situation where there are very strong efforts underway to make transfers happen, but there are continuing obstacles. And so we have a year left. Guantanamo has been open now almost as long as it's existed under President Obama, almost as long as it existed under President Bush. Right, in January, it will have existed longer under President Obama than under President Bush. And yet President Bush transferred four or five times as many detainees as the Obama administration. So, you know, that creates a situation as we get closer to the end of the administration where we see sort of one or two scenarios that may occur. Right? I think the conventional wisdom is that the most, sort of at best, the Obama administration is going to bring everybody who's left in Guantanamo at the end of next year to the United States for continued indefinite detention, right? That's going to import to the United States an indefinite detention regime that's existed in Guantanamo for 14 years. Worst case scenario is that the president declares defeat and leaves office and tries to blame the United States Congress and others for standing in his way. And I think, again, that's the conventional wisdom. We at the center think that there are other alternatives, but it's going to require a concerted effort, not just on our part, not just on the part of the State Department, but on the part of the international community. You know, it is essential that foreign governments emphasize to the United States how critically important it is to close the prison at Guantanamo. And I mean to do this on a bilateral, head of state to head of state basis, to emphasize the importance of closing Guantanamo, to ensure that it happens, to put pressure on Barack Obama, because he is the person that has the authority to do that. And it is also critically important for foreign governments, including in particular OAS member states, to agree to accept detainees from Guantanamo. The United States, Guantanamo is a problem created by the United States. The United States should accept these men into our country, but the reality is that's not going to happen, and that these men need foreign governments to come forward, to step forward, and to do what a number of governments have already done, and that is to offer to resettle some number of these men. So on behalf of the men, that's my request to all of you to please consider these men for resettlement. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Mr. Wells, thanks for bringing to this discussion the human perspective of the people deprived of liberty in Guantanamo. Our last speaker is Professor Rick Wilson. Richard Wilson is Emeritus Professor of Law of the Washington College of Law, American University here in Washington, D.C., where he has taught since 1989. He was the founding director of the International Human Rights Law Clinic, where he worked with students from 1990 through this summer in 2015. His litigation work includes representation of asylum seekers in the United States, detainees at Guantanamo Bay, in federal courts, military commissions, and in several U.S. capital cases, and here before the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights. Thank you, Professor Rick Wilson. You have the floor.
Antes de empezar, tengo entendido que hay muchos de ustedes que son hispanoparlantes primero y agradezco su paciencia, pero voy a tener que seguir en inglés. Pero después podemos discutir si quieren. Gracias. So, let me say I am indeed honored to be invited today to speak to you and to be a part of this panel on review of a commonly shared goal, as you've heard from all of us, about closing the base at Guantanamo, closing the prison at Guantanamo. I have reviewed the report in detail. It is a very well done report, accurate in all respects as of the time of its publication. And on reflection, one of my major reflections from the time of beginning work on these cases with the Center for Constitutional Rights back in about 2002, just after the initial detainees were taken into the base, and there was a request for precautionary measures on behalf of all the unnamed detainees at that time, in which my clinic and the center participated, there has been a groundswell, a change, a seismic shift, if you will, in the engagement of the international community with the intersections between international human rights law and international humanitarian law, the law of war. And the Commission has been in the forefront in sharpening that focus and in leading the way many times ahead of the U.S. courts in talking about what law applies in what situation. And that includes those landmark first precautionary measures on behalf of all of the detainees that said they all had a right to access to the courts, to habeas corpus, and to lawyers long before, 4 years before, the U.S. courts gave them that right themselves. So kudos to the Commission for its work and for its leadership in guiding us toward what we all share to be a goal. I also share Wells' concern about the urgency of the situation. I think the fact that we have only 1 year left in the Obama administration calls for the same kind of measures that Wells has called for in terms of the actions that are going to be taken. What I want to do today is three things. I want to talk a little bit about my own involvement in cases and my work with the students on these cases. I want to offer some updates if time permits, and then some comments on the report more generally, secondly, and then offer my own suggestions, which don't differ much from the other panelists with regard to the courses of action, just more now. My involvement in cases at Guantanamo goes back to 2002, as I said, as a clinical teacher at American University here in Washington and director of the International Human Rights Law Clinic. We took a case in 2004, just after the U.S. Supreme Court in the Rasool decision said that lawyers had access to the detainees and that the cases would be tried right here in Washington, D.C. That is, the cases would be heard in habeas corpus right here in Washington, D.C. All of us have worked, and I think this is almost universally true, without compensation. The lawyers who work in Guantanamo aren't paid fees. We all do this pro bono, and so I've been able to do this work over many, many years because of the generosity of the university and because of the support of the clinical program at American University. I mentioned that we were involved in the original filing of the request for precautionary measures, and we were also involved in later updates to those measures that Elizabeth alluded to. Our most significant client, though, was a young Canadian, a man named Omar Khadr, who was 15 years old at the time that he was detained in Afghanistan. We took his case right from the beginning, and Wells and I traveled among the first lawyers to arrive at Guantanamo in 2004. And we continued to represent him as civilian counsel in military commissions in the first iteration of those commissions, which was struck down by the U.S. Supreme Court in the Hamdan decision. Shortly after that decision, he substituted Canadian counsel for us and continued with military lawyers in the military commissions. And eventually, Omar pled guilty to an offense and before the military commissions and received effectively an 8-year sentence, some of which he continued to serve in Guantanamo and some of which he was committed to serve in Canada, his home country. He was transferred back there in 2010 after his guilty plea, and the commission's report brings it up to the time that he was put into medium security after his transfer there. I'm pleased to report, and this by way of update to the commission, that Omar has been freed from custody. He was released in May of 2015 and lives in Edmonton, Alberta, in Canada. He immediately, upon his release, has taken action in the Canadian courts against the Canadian government for its complicity in his detention. He's also recanted his guilty plea, saying that the only reason he pled guilty was in order to obtain his release, not because he was in fact guilty. He also denounced jihad in any form whatsoever and said all he wanted to do, as he has said from the beginning, is get on with his life. He's subsequently been permitted to travel to Toronto to visit his family by plane, obviously some risk that he might be seen as a no-fly risk, but he was permitted to do that, and a local college wants to help him with his studies to finish high school and enter college, which is, I think, as good an ending as one can hope for when one is released at age 28, having spent 13 years of his life wasted in that prison. Omar declined to file a petition with the commission. After long discussion, he felt strongly that the action would have no practical effect on his release. But he was willing to pursue precautionary measures. We sought precautionary measures, and they were granted. I have to say that we raised the issue of his being a juvenile and the need for his treatment as a juvenile, and thus the need for his the focus on his rehabilitation and reintegration into society rather than his continued detention. Per the treaties that the U.S. government has committed to on with regard to child soldiers. However, the commission didn't reach that issue. It simply issued the precautionary measures as though he were an adult without mentioning his childhood. And the report notes, and I think we didn't know this definitively at the time, that there were more than 20 children and teenagers detained at Guantanamo, some as young as 12 or 13, who were released during the time that they were there. So the children at Guantanamo are one of the most profound tragedies, and I think Omar's case is one of those that speaks strongly to the injustice of the system. Our second client, and these clients are all, I would say, fairly prototypical, and I would say fairly typical of the clients that the Center for Constitutional Rights has represented as well, was a young man named Polad Sirajov. He's a national of Azerbaijan, the only one from that country in the facility. He was cleared for release by the Joint Task Force and was subsequently transferred to Slovakia in January of 2010. And I would like to think that our advocacy on his behalf in the Joint Task Force was one of the most helpful steps in his release. Our third client remains at Guantanamo. His name is Salem Garebi. He's a Libyan citizen. He is one of the first to challenge his detention in the U.S. courts and one of the longest detainees there, and one of only 9 non-Yemeni detainees who has not yet been transferred, although he has been cleared for release. So, as Wells pointed out, These are individuals who have nothing whatsoever in their history to indicate that they have committed any wrong against any person at any time. And yet, it seems almost impossible to get them out of that place. I want to focus a little bit on a couple of updates. I think the major issues I would like to mention are the publication noted in the report by the Senate of the new study on Guantanamo done by the Senate on torture that was released in December of 2014. That has led to the issuance of a recent report at the beginning of this month from Human Rights Watch, again joining the chorus of organizations, including the Center, our clinic, and many, many others, the American Bar Association and many others, who have called for accountability for those who have been involved in torture through government activity. Those steps need to be taken, and I think if one looks at the trajectory of commission decisions over the years, it is a commonplace that the commission calls for investigation and prosecution of government officials who were involved in wrongdoing in all of the countries from which you all come, and so the U.S. should be held to no less standard. A second issue, I think of some interest to everyone, should be the question of what exactly is a war crime. This is something I know Wells is very much involved in. And this week in federal court, there is a case being argued, the Al-Balul case, which has to do with whether or not conspiracy can be a war crime at all. And a panel found that it could not. They're hearing the case en banc this week, meaning all of the judges of the circuit are sitting to hear that case. So it's a case of great significance and may set the tone for the upcoming trials of the high-value detainees. Let me close by mentioning that there's been some suggestion that the president has the unilateral power to close the prison. In fact, Clifford Sloan, your predecessor, and Greg Craig, the former White House counsel, have written an op-ed in the Washington Post suggesting that he has the authority to close the prison today if he wishes to under his presidential powers. Shortly after that op-ed, the Washington Post itself wrote a lead editorial suggesting that was not the best course of action and that the president is ultimately constrained by the financial limitations of his ability to do the things he needs to do without the help of Congress. I don't know the answer to the question. I don't know. My sense is that this is more a political than a legal question, and that the kinds of things that we have all urged, that is to order the release of the cleared individuals, to expedite the PRB process, and to suspend the military commissions, if possible, bringing those individuals into the United States for their petitions, and to end the hypocrisy of the government's aggressive posture in habeas corpus litigation at the same time that they're trying to close the facility, as Wells has pointed out. And I think I will stop there.
Oh, thank you, Professor Wilson. And after this reflection on the impact of the human rights litigation on real people's life, we are going to open the floor for a discussion, and we are inviting you to formulate questions also in Spanish. Si ustedes quieren, pueden presentar algunas preguntas en español, and we are going to translate it. And I also then to open the floor for the people who want to participate in this discussion. Entonces, las personas que quieran participar pueden pararse, tomar el micrófono y hacer sus preguntas. And we are going to take two or three questions and then answers. So we are pleased to have here Victor Rodriguez.
Thank you very much. I'm Victor Rodriguez from Costa Rica. I'm professor of 54 Mexican lawyers here. So we are going to make the question in English and after in Spanish, if possible. I want to ask to the panel, first of all, we are happy, so happy with the closure of Guantanamo. But my question has to do with how to make a lesson learned about the regime of Guantanamo, because Guantanamo is not only a physical closure of a prison. It has to do with the regime of restriction of the human rights, guarantees, and enemy kinds of acts, exceptional system or regime, not only in the States, but also in Europe, European countries as France and UK and so on. My question is how to make a public policy to avoid wrong practices inside Guantanamo, but outside of Guantanamo as a regime with the practices of torture, waterboarding o any other thing. I want to say it in Spanish. Lo que estoy diciendo es que Guantánamo no es solo cerrar una estancia física de una prisión, sino que hay un régimen detrás de restricciones de derechos civiles, de las libertades. No se restringen solo los derechos de las personas que están en prisión, sino de los ciudadanos y de los habitantes de Estados Unidos y de todo el mundo, que pueden ser acusados por un delito que entra dentro de una política o de una política pública que tiene que ver en este caso con un derecho penal del enemigo. Y estas acusaciones implicarían que hay un régimen excepcional, diferente, con un piso o un estándar de garantías que se está reduciendo en Francia por los actos terroristas en París, la práctica de torturas, el submarino, etcétera, deben de evitarse y deben de prohibirse. Y yo le agrego a esto un candidato presidencial a este país, bueno, todavía no, es un precandidato, dice que él reinstauraría la práctica del submarino. Entonces, ¿cuáles son las lecciones aprendidas que tendríamos que tener del cierre de Guantánamo, no solo hacia lo físico, sino hacia realmente restituir un derecho igual para todos y una garantía del debido proceso para todas las personas?
Gracias, Victor. Thank you, Victor.
Hola, Joy Olson de Wola. Mi pregunta es, bueno, gracias por las recomendaciones de la comisión, pero quiero saber si qué más puede hacer la comisión como institución en ¿qué es la palabra? Encouraging, to encourage countries in Latin America to take people. And then for Mr. Trumbull, what would be the impediment on the part of the U.S. government in transferring detainees who are cleared for release to Latin America? I'm trying to figure out how we get from where we are right now with this population of people who are already cleared to finding a place in which Latin America can help solve this problem.
Maybe another one question, please.
Ricardo Preciado from Mexico. Mr. Richard Wilson take the issue, but to Mr. Trumbull, how about what will happen with the state officers that were involved in torture? I mean, you represent the side of government, so, and Obama says he's going to close, but have you thought about that? maybe what's going to happen. It's a, in Spanish, it's a crimen de lesa humanidad. It's a crime, it's a, against humanity, so yes. Es una pregunta sobre qué pasará con los agentes del Estado que están involucrados en tortura. No, you said they recognize that the government says that they don't say that is there's no torture, because they just said that is an issue of state, I mean, security of state, but they don't deny it. So what will happen?
Thank you. Maybe if you can start and then just moving the word through the side of the table.
Okay, you'd like me to start with the first question? Okay, so the first question I think was about Guantanamo as a regime of indefinite detention. How do we prevent that? I think it's important to remember that Guantanamo was created, it was designed to be entirely outside of the law, and a place where the United States could do whatever it wanted to the detainees for as long as it wanted without any outside scrutiny. That was the product, it was the reaction to fear. It was the fear of came about. It was a response to the attacks of September 11th and the fear surrounding that. And it was all, you know, and in order to create this place outside the law, this legal version of outer space, it was necessary to do a couple of things. One, to reinterpret the law, to make things that had always been illegal lawful, to find exceptions in the law, and really to demonize the men who were brought there, to treat them, to demonize them, to treat them as if they were some, as if they were not human beings, right? That's the only way that you can commit acts of torture like those committed against the men in Guantanamo, is to treat them as if they are subhuman, right? On the one hand, you say they committed this spectacular attack on 9/11, they have these superhuman powers, but we're going to treat them as not even human, right? This is the psychology that allows a place like Guantanamo to exist, and it's not unique. This is not the first time that this happened in U.S. history, right? There is a long, unfortunate tradition in the United States of treating certain categories of marginalized people as something other than human. You know, when you go back and look at Native American populations, you look at Jim Crow and the Civil Rights era. You know, there are many examples of this. Unfortunately, I mean, it's quite tragic, and there are many international examples of this. Right? I mean, Guantanamo is not the first island prison that has existed in throughout the world. You know, you have Devil's Island and Robben Island and a number of other places just like Guantanamo. And so I think we need to begin to prevent this from happening in the future, begin to recognize and understand how it is that a place like Guantanamo is created, and to recognize and for institutions like the Commission to ensure that it's not possible to create exceptions, right? To hold the line and to resist the temptation in times of fear to create exceptions in the law for disfavored or marginalized groups of people.
On the first question, I couldn't agree more with what Wells just said. The words I wrote down in response to the question were fear and rage. If you recall those days immediately after the attacks of September 11th, the U.S. Was shocked. It was, I think, terrified to have experienced these attacks in ways that were so visually powerful and so devastating. And I think the desire of the government, the desire of the leaders of the government, is to show forceful response. And that was one of their efforts to do so. Unfortunately, as I mentioned earlier, this is one of those places where I think the government took advantage of the ambiguity between what is domestic law and what is international law, the law of war, what is the law of human rights and what is the law of war,
and argued that when war is engaged in, human rights stop. They can engage in whatever actions they need to take in order to carry out the war. At least that was the formal position of the United States with regard to the no-law zone that it created in Guantanamo. It also, though, I think Wells identifies the goal of lying outside the law, but once they began to think a little bit more, I think the goal was to try all of the individuals there for the crimes they allegedly committed that led to their capture. And what do we have? 8 convictions thus far, something like 1% of the individuals who have been detained over all of these years of the nearly 800 people who have been detained there have been convicted of any crime. Some still in process, but the goals have been colossal failures. The goals, the original goals of the government. How to prevent it? I'm not sure if we look at the current situation in France and the responses of our presidential candidates here in the United States to those attacks that we have learned the lessons, and I'm not sure whether we ever will, whether human beings are capable of not responding with that sort of desire for vengeance or that let's find a culprit, let's find someone we can blame. In this case, oftentimes identified as Muslims, and blame them as a group rather than taking the care to identify the legal questions that are involved, to protect the legal rights of those individuals who are involved in those cases, and to hope that we won't repeat them again.
I certainly agree that it is a significant challenge, and you know, I'm not sure if we've learned all the lessons over the past, you know, 13 or 14 years, but I think there is some reason for optimism. There's been a tremendous amount of scrutiny into what happened, you know, in terms of treatment, interrogation methods. There's been a lot of a lot greater transparency, and I think many people have come to the conclusion that this is not who we are, and that this is not effective. And you know, certainly the Senate report, is one example of that. I also think that there are some very positive examples of how we have, in the face of potential terrorist suspects or acts, we have relied on our criminal justice system, and we have realized that in many of the cases that is really the preferable way to go, and that is fully capable of protecting our national security, but also, you know, providing all of the rights and guarantees that defendants are entitled to. One example is the Christmas, the aborted Christmas Day bombing with the underwear bomber. He was, you know, trying to blow up a plane full of civilians. He was arrested and he was put into the criminal justice system. He was given his Miranda rights, and he was, he actually decided to cooperate, and he was convicted and is serving out a life sentence. So I think that kind of proving that our criminal justice system is capable of handling these threats and protecting our national security is extremely important.
So I think there are 2 points that I would just respond to quickly. What more can the Commission do to encourage other countries to receive detainee transfers? This report is an effort to reach out not only with recommendations to the U.S. government, but also to reach out within the region to provide a human rights perspective and analysis on the problematic and look at what the path is towards closure of Guantanamo, and for the Commission to continue transmitting its consistent messages over time about the illegality of the ongoing detention and about the need for renewed, redoubled efforts to reach closure, and third countries receiving detainees is one necessary component. So the Commission has its report, it has its press release on the report, it has a multimedia outreach process. This event is part of that process. The commission will continue to talk about this report and to launch the report wherever it is that people have an interest in hearing about this report. So if there's interest out there, let us know and we can collaborate. The commission will continue to monitor the situation as part of a larger process and will continue to transmit these messages. The other point I wanted also to respond to, because it is so essential, is the question of lessons learned. What does this mean? Where do we go from here? And this report, in a certain part of its objectives, has to do with documentation, and it's an opportunity for the commission to have an integral overview of the different components that it's been looking at over time. And what the commission has been looking at and responding to, and what we see through the torture memos and the other policies, especially in the early years, was a programmatic effort to deconstruct basic guarantees for this group of detainees, a programmatic effort toward deconstruction. And it's taken many years and many court decisions and a lot of monitoring of international mechanisms to reconfirm that these are basic and non-derogable guarantees, and to get us reaffirmed and back to the place where we would have been starting out. It's been a very long process. Accountability is, I think, what the commission is looking at is the key in terms of lessons learned right now. Accountability for those who tortured, accountability for those who ordered the torture, accountability for those who designed this programmatic effort to deconstruct basic guarantees. And the conditions have to be put in place to be able to achieve that accountability, which means access to information. It means declassification of information. It means lifting restrictions on detainees so that they can denounce what they experienced, so that they're not restricted by classification from denouncing the circumstances under which they were tortured. These are necessary components in a process of accountability. The commission will continue to look at this question of accountability through the individual case system. The Amezian case is in the merits stage right now. The commission will be looking at that. The commission has other cases that directly or indirectly look at similar problems. And just to close, I want to say that the discrimination aspect of this problem is an especially challenging and problematic set of issues that requires a lot more consideration. We in the commission were just really scratching the surface of this aspect of the problem in this report, but it's something that needs to be dealt with as we go forward in time in much greater depth.
Mm-hmm. There is the last question, the third question.
There's one more. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, we have
yes, a, yes. The, exactly. You can.
I just answered everything. So you can. Okay.
There's a discussion, and actually there is the last question who is pending to have an answer. Maybe you, Mr. Trumbull, can start this round.
Well, Joy, first of all, I want to say thank you for everything that WOLA is doing. It's been a great resource for us. In terms of what else the commission can do, I think the work of the commission is very important. We support its work. I think the message right now is that we are in the final stage. It is, it's now or never. And we do need the help of our allies. This is a shared objective. The OAS has repeatedly called on, and the commission has repeatedly called on the United States to close Guantanamo, but we can't do it by ourselves. We do need the help of our friends and allies. And it's not a politically easy decision. But there's one important point, less than 10%, this data is from the summer, less than 10% of detainees transferred under this administration are even suspected or confirmed of engaging in any sort of terrorist or insurgent activities. And I think that the commission needs to continue to stress that it's not easy, but if we're going to achieve this mutual objective, then we have to work together. In terms of the impediments, obviously we have the restrictions, the unwarranted restrictions that have been imposed by Congress. Although We still have the flexibility to continue with foreign transfers, and that's why I'm optimistic that we will increase the pace of transfers in 2016. But right now, the key determination is that the Secretary of Defense has to certify that steps will be taken to, quote, substantially mitigate the risk that detainees may pose. And so that's why we have to work with receiving governments to talk about those steps that can be taken to substantially mitigate any risk of re-engagement. But I think it's definitely possible, and we can work through those issues. So I don't see any serious impediments, and I think we should definitely move forward with those discussions. And then in terms of the last question, on kind of accountability for past acts, I think our position is spelled out in our March 30th submission. And so, because I don't want to mess up any of the facts, I would refer you to that submission for kind of a greater detail on what's been done and kind of the investigations, the measures that have been taken to hold people accountable. So I would refer you to that submission.
The last question is a great question. I think the question of accountability for those who are engaged in torture has been addressed at the most minor levels, and I think there are some people complicit in torture who have been disciplined either within the military or otherwise. But the accountability for those most responsible, for those who gave the orders, I don't believe will happen. I don't think there's the political will in the United States for that to happen. Both the former president and the vice president have written in books that they're proud of what they did and they would do it again, and believe that what they did was right. Those confessions of complicity, in my view, I don't think go very far in the political arena today towards the possibility of prosecution at that level by any means. Congress has passed a number of provisions that relate to Guantanamo and to other detentions that have attempted to raise the bar more with regard to criminal responsibility for those who are complicit in these crimes. And I think the Obama administration has announced long ago that it doesn't intend to prosecute at the command level with regard to those who may be complicit in torture. So I don't see it as a possibility.
I would just add one or two points on that. So I agree. I don't think that the Obama administration is going to take any meaningful steps to ensure accountability for torture, particularly torture committed by the CIA. But I do think that there is a possibility that accountability will come in time, in two ways. I mean, we at the Center for Constitutional Rights are very interested in the issue of accountability, in part because we have a client who was tortured as part of the CIA program. And, you know, what we've seen historically, and particularly in the experience of other countries, is that reckoning with similar issues is that it often can take 15 or 20 years to achieve that kind of accountability, and it often will come in some sort of an international forum, if not in the domestic legal through the domestic legal system. You know, you see that with the Pinochet case, right? I mean, and so we have some hope that there will be accountability, if not during the Obama administration, in future administrations in the United States or internationally. And one of the things that we're doing at the center is trying to use principles of universal jurisdiction to ensure accountability, right? If the United States is unwilling or unable to arrest and prosecute torturers, either those people who committed the acts of torture or those people who authorized and conspired to allow the torture to happen, We have been pushing countries like France, Germany, Spain, that have strong universal jurisdiction laws to arrest these individuals. And you know, there are some examples of how that that might work. I mean, there was the case of there was a rendition of a cleric named Abu Omar from Italy to Egypt in 2003, and the Italians prosecuted a number of U.S. officials for that. And there was, I believe it was one of those individuals, I believe was arrested, I think he was in Panama, if I'm remembering correctly, and detained initially for a period of time on an Interpol warrant or arrest warrant that had been issued by the Italians for this individual. And so, you know, you don't see people like John Yoo, who is the author of the torture memo, you don't see people like John Yoo really traveling outside the United States. Right, and so there are these principles of universal jurisdiction that we are pursuing, and we will continue to pursue to try to bring these people to justice, if not in the United States, in other countries. And it may take some time, but we're going to continue to do it.
Like 6 minutes left, and we have time for another round of questions. And please. I take the floor, but I would like to invite also our colleagues and fellows and former interns to participate in this discussion, please.
On Mr. Dixon's sayings, okay, fear created Guantanamo, right? How many more Guantanamos we expect? Because there's a lot of fear right now.
Well, yes, fear is one of the main reasons that Guantanamo exists. I think there are other reasons. Racism is one. Fear of the unknown. These all contribute to Guantanamo. I think, you know, the only way to ensure that we don't have more of this, right, is to demand accountability for what happened, right? To demand accountability for the torture, to recognize what happened. I think it's why the report is so important, because it's a documentation, you know, it provides documentation of what happened. But, you know, you see in the current political discourse in the United States proposals to restrict anyone who's Muslim from entering the United States, anyone. And so we seem to be moving in the wrong direction. And so, you know, we certainly have our work cut out for us, and we have to continue to fight on.
Good morning. Just first in English and then in Spanish. We have been noticed that the Higgs case has been notified to the Human Rights Committee of the United Nations. This case concerns an Australian citizen who was detained at Guantanamo Bay without a legal process after he was found guilty from a military judge for joining up ISIS terrorist group. Our doubt is about two questions. The first, what would happen if a UN Committee on Human Rights decided that Mr. Higgs was illegally detained at Guantanamo Bay and afterwards in Australia? And the second one is, which should be the consequences of a declaration of the UN Human Rights Committee about the extraterritorial application of the International Covenant of Civil and Political Rights. En español, bueno, hemos sabido que ya eso es noticia de la última sesión del Comité de Derechos Humanos de Naciones Unidas, que al comité le ha sido notificado el caso Higgs. El caso Higgs concierne a un ciudadano de Australia, australiano, quien se autorreclutó en las tropas de ISIS y fue a combatir a Medio Oriente. Obviamente, lo atrapan y lo llevan preso a Guantánamo Bay. Los Estados Unidos lo saben, lo procesan con un juicio militar y lo tienen en Guantánamo por 7 años. Australia sabe, pero no actúa, no hace nada, y más bien a la hora de saber se pone de acuerdo con los Estados Unidos para que la pena pueda terminar de cumplirse en Australia. Entonces, nuestra duda es qué pasaría si el Comité de Derechos Humanos, donde ha llegado el caso, se expresara para una responsabilidad internacional de los Estados, bueno, de Australia en realidad, por no aplicar los derechos humanos y en particular los derechos contemplados en el Pacto de Derechos Civiles y Políticos, pero también qué pasa con la extraterritorialidad del Pacto Internacional de Derechos Civiles y Políticos, cuáles serían las consecuencias de una declaración de este tipo. También, y añado, sobre todo considerando que el comité en la penúltima sesión declaró su preocupación en materia de extraterritorialidad de la aplicación de los derechos humanos con respecto a los drones que están siendo utilizados en particular por Estados Unidos y que en este momento los países occidentales, el primer ministro de Italia y de Francia tiene miedo de que se puedan utilizar por actos terrorísticos en esos países. Gracias.
That's a great question. I think the Hicks case was going on at the time that we were doing Omar Khadr's case in the first military commissions. So I'm somewhat acquainted with it. I think the decision, a decision from the UN body has the same sort of moral force as decisions from this commission to the United States. That is, they're not legally binding, but governments, as is their wont, honor them or not, and they create a set of precedents based on a firm grounding in international law with clear analysis that suggests that the government of those states is responsible for the wrongdoings in question. I think the question of extraterritorial jurisdiction in human rights cases, the decision by the commission in the very first precautionary measures decision in Guantanamo was one of the first to apply jurisdiction, if you will, extraterritorially, although within the Americas, because we're talking about detainees being held by the United States in Cuba, all within the Organization of American States. Other questions have been raised, and the European Court and some of the UN bodies have grappled with the question of whether or not their jurisdiction should extend to extraterritorial acts around the globe. And in fact, I believe our clinic has a case pending here with the Commission where detainees were held in Iraq and under U.S. control. And our argument is that the U.S. is responsible for the very same reasons that they were responsible in Guantanamo, because it's not where they are, it's who controls them. If the government has these individuals under their control and power, they are responsible. At least that's my view. I don't know if, I think the commission has expressed that view a couple of times. And I think it shouldn't depend on whether you're within the hemisphere or not. I think it should be a global rule as well. So that's my own view.
Okay, I'm gonna make two footnotes. The first footnote is the Inter-American Commission's position on extraterritoriality is very much following what Rick Wilson was saying. Effective control is the primary characteristic. And the best source to understand the Commission's approach to extraterritoriality is an admissibility report on the interstate case between Ecuador and Colombia that had to do with a killing as a result of bombing by Colombia of a presumed FARC camp in Ecuadorian territory. So the admissibility report in that case from a couple of years ago covers the entire evolution of the Commission's thinking through the sources. So that's a good way to see it. And the second thing is with respect to the weight of a recommendation from the Inter-American Commission, similar to the logic of the Human Rights Committee. What the Commission has always said about its determinations in cases or precautionary measures or other kinds of reports is the Commission is a charter-based principal organ of the Organization of American States. The Commission, as a principal organ, is the authoritative finder of fact and law in human rights under the American Convention and the American Declaration. So when the Commission issues a recommendation, It does so as the authoritative organ of supervision, and the member states have the obligation, to use good faith to implement those recommendations. The Inter-American Court has said the same thing with respect to the American Convention and the American Declaration. So I just wanted to mention that it's not discretionary, it's not optative, it is an obligation to use good faith. Thank you.
I don't know if you have, you want to close with some reflections or because I'm really concerned about the time and all this, the people who is here. Preguntaría si ustedes tienen interés de hacer otra pregunta o si quieren que hagamos ya un cierre. If there is another person who wants to participate, formulate questions. Okay. So I think that we are finishing, and we are on time. So I would like to just make a small comment, because as the Assistant Executive Secretary said, this roundtable was another effort of the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights to promote a discussion on these issues and to present the report towards the closure of Guantanamo. We want to thank all of you for your participation, and particularly to our panel for this high discussion. Queremos agradecerles a todos por su participación y decirles que además tenemos los libros, los reportes los encuentran a la salida de la sala y los pueden tomar, están tanto en inglés como en español. Y indicarles, por favor, que no olviden tomar todas sus pertenencias, porque van a hacer un cambio del el formato de la sala para que ustedes puedan seguir con sus clases. Thank you very much to everybody.